Alrighty, so yeah, well, I threw in all the keywords, of course, because that's what you gotta do these days, right? But what I'm gonna do today is I'm gonna talk about how we're using generative AI for improving app quality and developer productivity. And, you know, I'm gonna talk about how things work under the hood a little bit, as much as I can. And I'm gonna show a pretty cool demo. And after that, if you're not a believer already, I think you're going to see why generative AI is a game changer for all of this in testing. And let me know if I'm not being loud. But okay, yeah, so this is me. You heard all the keywords. And I think the TLDR is that I've been doing machine learning for software testing for the past like 5.5 years. And before that, I taught robots how to thread needles, which didn't always work, but it was fun. And also taught drones how to navigate and find defects on services. That one actually worked pretty well. So yeah, I've been doing machine learning for like 12 years. No regrets. And okay, now, DragonCrawl, LLMs for mobile testing. Why the heck do we need to build something like this? And the reason is that traditional mobile testing, which is usually with scripts like Appium and stuff like that, are pretty fragile. So every time there is a change in a button, like just the text or location or the IDs, you know, any small things like that, those break the apps. And not because they're a box, but simply because those scripts need to be updated. And at a place like Uber, we spend thousands of developer hours per month updating those scripts. And, you know, that fact alone is pretty bad. But as a consequence, we cannot shift to the left. So because the SNR is so low, we cannot run this test to block PRs. We cannot run them as early as possible. And finally, at a place like Uber, with 700 mobile engineers, 3,000 backend engineers running in so many cities, thousands of cities, and thousands of concurrent experiments, it's pretty much impossible to test all of that manually. And it's extremely expensive to author and maintain tests for all of that. So what we did was we worked on DragonCrawl to address those three pain points. So we fine-tuned LLMs so that they could get through these minor flow changes, these minor UI changes, and execute with a very high pass rate to the point that we can shift to the left. And with DragonCrawl, you train once and it works in many cities, code-free and maintenance-free. And finally, the model that we use is 1,000 times smaller than ChatGPT. So financially, we can run this at scale in a way that makes sense. And okay, now how does the magic happen? So DragonCrawl operates with view hierarchies, which are essentially text representations of the screen dumped in a huge XML, which we parse with some rules, and we extract the actions that we can take on the UI elements. Then we combine those with the goals of the test, and we turn that into prompts. And those are the inputs to DragonCrawl. And then the outputs that we get are the actions that are most likely to take us to accomplish our goal based on the training data that we have. Now, as a consequence of this, what this means is that if we get an unexpected screen, Dragon is going to suggest an action that is going to be similar to what it has seen and that will be conducive to the goal. So if you see a screen, for example, where you have to accept some terms and conditions, Dragon's probably going to say cancel or something like that. Or if it sees something pretty strange, it may just restart the app. And it may not get it right on the first attempt, but what we have seen is that it eventually, and without trying really hard, makes the right decisions and finds the path. And now here is something where we are thinking differently. So in traditional testing, you touch a button, you assert. You load a screen, you assert. But here, because these assertions in Appium and other frameworks, they're just based on IDs or text and things like that, which could change and would require maintenance, we saw that as a problem to overcome. And instead of doing that, we divorce flow execution from assertion. So as we execute the steps to complete the flow, we record the screenshots. And then after we finish, which we know by the final screen that we're supposed to get to, we assert things on the screens. So we always look for ANRs, we look for unlocalized content, and that we do for all the screens, but there are specific screens where we look for specific things. So here's one example for London. And specifically for London, we need to look for Well, it's pretty pixelated, but specifically for London, we need to look for driver selfie, license plate, vehicle details, some vehicle, right? And if we don't, we could lose our license in London. So it's pretty high priority to visually look for certain things. That would be pretty expensive to do manually, like every second, every hour. No, we cannot do that, right? So we have specific models for that. And what we're working towards is something like this. So this is not in production yet, but this is literally what the prototype code looks like. We are framing assertions as visual question answering, which is a problem that people have worked on since like 2012 when I was in my PhD. And what we do is literally just take a screen and take a prompt, and that's the assertion. So the question that you want answered, that is a prompt, which gets executed as an assertion. So here's an example, right? Developers won't have to look for IDs, won't have to handcraft their own models to look for ads. No, they're just going to ask, is there an ad? And send us a screen. Or here. Oh, by the way, this image is not mine. I got it from Reddit. We are going to send it and ask, for example, if we have alcohol drinks. And yes, we have Corona here. So we return true or false, meaning the assertion passed or failed, and a justification. We're really excited about this. And now here's some of our wins. Regarding quality, we have detected 11 high priority bugs. And these are the type of bugs that would prevent riders from requesting trips, drivers from accepting trips, and things like that. And every time one of those gets out, we lose like $2 million. So it's a lot of money saved right over there. Also, like I mentioned, like localization, we look for unlocalized content on the screens, and we have found around 100 of those. And you guys may not be aware, but every once in a while, tries to break into new markets, either through new products or new cities or new languages, and they use DragonCrawl. And in Q1, I think, they use DragonCrawl to help streamline language quality for Catalan. We had a pretty nice announcement, lots of thumbs up. They also did it for Bengali and also Pashto and Dari. And now those two are pretty close to my heart because we streamlined the launch in Pashto and Dari when the Afghan refugee crisis was happening. And we did it to help them onboard as drivers. So in a way, we contributed to ameliorating a humanitarian crisis. And finally, we joined forces with the chaos testing team. So now Dragon can inject faults in the backend, you know, like minor delays, aborts, and stuff like that in unassuming services, meaning nothing should happen. But we have found a lot of surprises. We have found 19 bugs of the highest, most destructive kind that could lose us $2 to $10 million. So the impact is fantastic. And I'm pretty sure we're going to find more surprises as we increase coverage. And yeah, here are some sample bugs. So here's one, right? Classical. Dragon was touching the checkbox right before requesting a trip, but it couldn't because this thing kept staying disabled for whatever reason. So we blocked the release. We prevented it from going to customers, saved a couple million. This one is one of those from fault injection. We timed out a service, pretty unassuming service, very low priority. The trip should have completed, but we got this, oops, you cannot request a trip. And finally, at localization bugs, they tend to be low priority because usually they don't really prevent you from booking a trip. But in this case, right, Dragon is trying to do a trip in Canada, and that's a language in India. And it took the right action, but then it got the terms and conditions in English. And well, we got it fixed. We prevented a lawsuit potentially. And in terms of productivity, lots of productivity gains. So this is kind of what it looks like, what the life of the DragonCrawl engineers looks like. So pass rate is 99%, right? And no maintenance since December last year. And you see over here, every once in a while, something goes down a bit, but it's infrastructure failures that we cannot really control, or it's real bad stuff, right? Like this P0 outage that we detected 16 hours before everybody else at Uber. We're pretty happy about that one. One high priority bug that we detected before anybody else. or actually, no, for this one, we were the only ones that got it. And for this one, the last one, we were like 25 minutes late, but that's fine. Still pretty quick. So yeah, the SNR for us is pretty high. It's 90% year to date, but since Q2, it's 100%. We haven't made mistakes. We haven't filed duplicate tickets, nothing. And as you see, it's just 100% all the time, pretty much. So we don't spend time triaging, unlike traditional testers. And regarding coverage, on every Android CD build, we execute some of our core flows in 5 cities and 2 languages. So around 90 cents per day. And during the weekends, closer to release time, we run in 184 cities and 55 languages, you know, just to make sure we keep our top markets healthy. And because we cover so many cities and languages with just one go, we have saved over 30,000 developer hours in test authorship alone. And we can't really compute maintenance, but we're all assuming it's pretty high. And now we have a pretty cool demo. I'm going to show you one driver, one dragon controlling a driver, one dragon controlling a rider. They don't know that each other exists, but they're going to work together to execute a trip. And on the left, you're going to see the driver. On the right, you're going to see the rider. And the driver is just going to go online and essentially just wait to get the trip request. And the rider on the other side is going to select the drop-off location and do all of the things it needs to do to request a trip. Oh, and here we have something pretty funny. So the driver opened the trip planner for whatever reason to see if it's missing any trips or whatever. And now the rider will touch confirm. The driver gets the trip request. It's going to accept it. And here we go. So now it's going to start the trip and Dragon is going to close the rider because it says, I know I'm on my way. I know I'm done. But now look, the driver going to pop up. And look, it gets it again. And it's going to click on OK. Boom, it touched it. Okay. So that is exactly the type of thing that trips a traditional mobile test. A traditional test would just freak out with that pop-up. But Dragon didn't. Dragon decided to, hey, let's just do something, see if it works. And it found the path, right? And here, it swiped right and completed the trip. So, okay, I cannot get out. Happens. There we go. Okay, so what happened here? The driver got a pop-up that was not expecting. I actually didn't even know the screen existed. And first, Dragon decided to wait, and it didn't work. But then it said, okay, I don't want to get stuck here, so let's just click on OK. And then that worked. And this is why we have this 99% pass rate. This is why, as you see, we're resilient to UI changes. And this is why, in general, AI and decision-based testing is the way to go for a place like Uber. And how are we doing with time? Okay, 5 minutes. Well, we're going to do some Q&A after this one. But yeah, so what's next for us? The assertions model that you saw, cross-platformizing Dragon, increasing coverage, and even using Dragon for bug reproduction. And, well, I think that's it for now. So now it's your time to ask me questions. Oh, I was supposed to put a QR code here, but I forgot. So yeah, this is my email. You can find me on LinkedIn. I don't bite humans or pets. Apparently, we need to clear that out, right? So, righty. What do you guys want to know? Okay.